These visible and lucrative positions are usually regarded as too hot for women to handle because of myths of women's family responsibilities, which will not allow them to stay behind and work late hours. Women's limited physical strength and risk of breaking down due to stress. So you find institutional reluctance in deploying women to such positions as director, finance and accounts, director of procurement, secretary of tenders board, PA or SA to permanent secretary or minister, facility manager. You know such positions, they are hot positions. Chief protocol officer is the men that are allowed to do these jobs. The implication of this is that when men and women reach management grades, the men arrive with more requisite experience and exposure and stand better chances of getting promotion than the women. Thus, in the structure of opportunity, female officers clearly stand disadvantaged. At the higher levels of the civil service and other organizations, the job becomes tedious in terms of coordination, conceptualization, and working under stress. Women are seen in the eyes of society as the weaker sex. The Nigerian worldview also concerns women to home and child rearing as their primary constituency. So every other thing you're doing is just, by the way, secondary. These have led to a lot of stereotyping and assumptions about the quality of women's work and about their being generally regarded in work organizations as less productive than men. So a third factor is the issue of the embedded stereotypes which have congealed into personal problems commonly associated with women in work organizations. It is important that we analyze these personal problems commonly associated with women managers in order to answer the question of whether sex differences make a difference in management and in leadership. It's very, very important that you understand what you're up against in the work organization. If you understand what you're up against, it will change your attitude. It will change the way you relate with people in the office. I heard some of the comments you were making, and I'm quite happy that I was here when those comments were being made, because this my presentation kind of ties up some of those loose ends after what you heard from the former presenter. So there are actually problems that are commonly associated with women in work organizations, and why the people don't see them as good candidates for leadership positions. But what I have done is to look at those problems. Are they real? Are they myths? You'll find that some of them are true and some of them are false. But we women, the attitude and the behavior we put up reinforces these myths. There are certain things we do and we make these myths to be true. And then when you behave like that, you do a whole world of harm to other women who are working very hard and trying to be taken seriously. The first of these myths.
Okay, I hope I'm there.
Yes. So the first of these myths relates to absenteeism and turnover rates. It is often assumed, you can see a woman carrying a baby there, that due to family responsibilities, women take more time off work, and that they leave jobs more frequently than men, that a female boss will be distracted from work by family responsibilities. Now, how true is this? Women are also said to absent themselves from work when they are ill, or their husbands are ill, or their children are ill, or their parents or parents-in-law fall ill. And you know that one of these people will fall ill. So, now, the E.E. Sobol Management Scholar captures the salience of this situation thus. Absenteeism in women is more compounded because they are the placentas of the family. The totality of the family centers around the creature woman, with the family web woven around her, especially during the childbearing age. It is nauseating to want to recruit a female because of her volatile absenteeism at work. That is what men think about us. Some of the causes of the frequent movement of women in jobs have been identified as follows. You have younger female workers who leave their jobs to further their education. They can decide to settle down to raise a family after marriage. Especially those of us here who have daughters, you know, she will marry wherever the man is, she has to go and meet him there. The husband can get transferred, the father can get transferred. Then the problem of inadequacy of daycare facilities or substandard daycare facilities. You know that if it is a junior or low-level worker that is absent, it will not cause disruption. But when women in skilled professional or top positions are absent, it will cause the shelving of important meetings, the postponement of important meetings, assignments, and even cause a delay in vital organizational decision making. No serious organization wants that. The assumed primacy of women's domestic commitments leads to prejudice against them. And as Spencer and Podmore found out in their research, it detracts from the notion that women can be committed professionals, and this damages their prospects for advancement into the highest levels of the organizational hierarchies. Now, how true is this myth? I keep asking. I went into research to find out. Gordon and Strober noted that present-day women aspirants to professional careers, they represent a new breed of women managers who are committed to triple goals: career, marriage, and children. I can see you all here. You are committed to all these goals. You want to have your career, you want to have your marriage, you want to have your children. That is the new breed of women we have in the world of work. And they further explain that unlike our few female predecessors, the women of today in the world of work are also as unwilling to let a career rule out possibilities of marriage as they are to set aside career goals for those of home and health. This willingness to make two commitments is not unique to women contemplating or pursuing business careers. It has become the modus operandi for the majority of young professional women. So when you decide to work, that is the commitment you have made. And she said, make your personal commitment. You're committing to career, marriage, children, and that is work. Now, it is undeniable that the attempt to merge what for women once seemed to be two separate lifestyles presents considerable difficulties. There are complexities which arise in dual career families, and they make women's roles difficult indeed. Despite the fact that many succeed in carving out for themselves challenging careers. So the society will saddle the working woman with conflicting expectations and roles, and put the woman under pressure. And those that buckle under this pressure will either have to give up work and sacrifice their promising professional careers for family duties. This same conflict is not found among working men. This is why the general perception is that there are incompatibilities between career and family goals. Those of us who are working, that is our primary job, to prove that there is no such incompatibility and that we can do it. Thus, this is one of the myths that hinder women's progress in management. That females are more unreliable because they tend to leave their jobs more frequently than men. But this myth has been laid to rest by Strober, who reports that where age and type of job are held consistent, both male and female turnover rates, they are equal, and that they can be reduced by any company that conscientiously seeks to do so. It is not just women that can be found leaving organizations. Men also leave. And they usually leave because of pay. So you know the reasons why women leave. Therefore, the myth that women feature more in absenteeism and labor turnover rates and are unreliable and should not be put in management or sensitive positions should be put to rest. Let me also stress here that career women should be prepared to work extra hard to balance their family and their work lives. They should not use family obligations as an excuse for truancy. I think there's one of the participants here who mentioned it, that your behavior will show whether you will be taken seriously or not. When women always present domestic responsibilities as reason to be excused from demanding work situations, they reinforce this myth and stereotype. Now, the second one, myth, which is, somebody has already raised it up here as a question. Lack of acceptance by women complaining of lack of acceptance by superiors, peers, and subordinates who express their preference to work for a male boss than a female manager. And this brings to the fore the second myth about women managers, that they are neither acceptable to their superiors nor to their peers and subordinates. Sholan K.M., another management theorist, observes that one of the problems facing Nigerian female employees is the lack of acceptability by other employees, colleagues, and subordinates, some of whom are still very conservative about a woman's ability in a leadership role. Most men find it difficult to accept the authority of a female supervisor. Furthermore, there are men who, because of their backgrounds, find it difficult to relate to female colleagues, not to talk of accepting a female as a boss. I remember I had an officer once who couldn't look a woman in the face. Anytime we were discussing with him, he would have his face on the ground. And then one day I told him, "Do you know you have the most handsome smile in the world?" He almost collapsed. And truly, he had the most amazing white teeth. But you know, every time you're talking to him, he will have his face on the ground because he can't look at a woman in the face. But he's married, you know. So these kinds of behavior undoubtedly creates a healthy tension in the workplace. The kind of tension that one of our participants talked about when you have this type of problem. Now, the presence of women executives may also create conflict for other women, surprisingly. Like you said over there, about women who are not comfortable with fellow women in management positions. And how do they react? They exhibit hostility towards other women in higher level positions. There are also subordinates who create special problems for women managers as well, because they find it difficult to take orders given by females. Male workers find it difficult to relate to their female colleagues and to female bosses. So what explanations can we put forward for the existence of this situation? I agree with the perspective that the problems encountered by women in work organizations in general, that they reside in the characteristics of individuals. This implies that the problem of acceptability of women as bosses is attitudinal, and therefore it is the behavior of individuals towards female managers that must change.